KWTV 9, the spirit of Oklahoma. Oklahoma's news leaders, Mitch Jelniger, Gene Wheatley with the farm news, and Nelson Robinson with the weather. This is Newsline 9, Morning Edition.
Oklahomans remember those killed in Central America.
And the search continues for two men who escaped from a Muskogee County jail. Good morning. I'm Mitch Jelniker. Those stories are just ahead.
And I'm Alicia Malaby, along with Nelson Robinson and Gene Wheatley. Good morning.
Good morning, Alicia. I like your grapey box. That's beautiful.
Thank you. Grapey.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty.
Great
flag. Nelson seersucker coach.
And your red tie, though, takes the show.
You like my little bow tie? Yes, there you go. See, I've actually got a neck now. Down, you know. Anyway, Sarah Branscombe's been with us this morning. Sarah cooked up a bunch of beef. Go teach you how to cook beef in the microwave, which has always been kind of a stumper to me. Anyway, you know, things straighten out, and I've got to think about it.
Do you have a microwave?
Yes, I do.
Okay, I
love it.
Maybe that was one of your problems. If you didn't have one, it'd be tough to cook on.
Yeah, well, too stiff. Well, anyway.
Yeah.
Okay. I agree.
Anyway.
yesterday, what could we say? I keep throwing
it was very nice.
It was on a scale of 1 to 10, it was a 9.9.
That's true.
Yeah, really beautiful. It's going to be very close to that today. We're going to try to top it. I don't know how close we'll get. 9.6, 9.7 maybe. Let's take a look at the temperatures around the area right now. Somewhat on the cool side, but we'll be looking for a rapid warm-up this morning. It's about 30 minutes from now. The sun begins to peak up over the horizon. 41 presently here in Oklahoma City, and very light winds make for no wind chill, so I don't have that for you today. Get your sunglasses ready, because it's going to be another beauty.
Yeah,
great. Okay, great.
Great.
We'll check in with you later.
Very good.
Thanks, Nelson. In the news this morning, this is Central America Awareness Week in Oklahoma, and yesterday, members of the Interreligious Task Force held a memorial service for more than 100,000 who have died in that region. Newsline 9's Lola Hall reports.
It was a small but passionate group that gathered on the hillside of McGinnis High School. They had come to remember their neighbors in Central America who have died in the struggle for freedom.
Although it is a voice crying in the desert, no to violence, yes to peace.
A giant map of Central America was painted on the grass as the names of the countries rang out: Costa Rica, Nicaragua, Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala. Each time the group hammered the crosses into the grass, each cross representing 999 plus one. Sister Benedicta said they wanted to make people understand the numbers of deaths that have happened in the last 5 years.
You know, 22,000 people are dying per year in countries that are so small, that fit within our own, you know, like Salvador is smaller than the state of Massachusetts. And we have 53,000 dead within the past 5 years. It's unthinkable.
Sister Benedicta said altogether 108,000 have died. Central America Awareness Week will culminate March 24th on the anniversary of the assassination of Archbishop Oscar Romero of El Salvador. The Archbishop sympathized with the poor and called for a stop to repression. He was killed in 1980 following Mass. Sister Benedicta says the crosses will stand as a memorial to him and a reminder to everyone who sees them to work and pray for peace. Lola Hall, Newsline 9.
Four men are thankful for their lives this morning after walking away from two separate plane crashes. In Lawton, a World War II vintage bomber crashed into a muddy field after both of its twin propeller engines went out. The plane was being flown from Ada to Frederick to be displayed in a museum. Pilot Ray Cunningham and passengers Jerry Morse and Sherman French were unharmed. The bomber was destroyed. In another accident, a student pilot from Denton, Texas, walked away from the wreckage of his single-engine plane after he was forced to make an emergency landing near McAllister. Robert Kuhn says his plane stalled over Lake McAllister before he could make a fueling stop.
A statewide alert has been issued for the capture of two Muskogee County jail inmates. The two men escaped yesterday morning after overpowering a jailer and making off with his gun and his car. Authorities identify the two escapees as Jackie Collins of Ardmore and Jackie Harris of Muskogee. Collins was awaiting sentencing on a rape and molestation conviction. Harris was awaiting trial on a parole violation. Muskogee County Sheriff Bill Van Zant says the two men are considered dangerous. For more information is expected today concerning the much-talked-about Phillips Petroleum Stock Exchange. After the hostile takeover attempt by Carl Icahn, Phillips offered to exchange the oil stock for $62 a share in debt notes. The company will then acquire the shares for a prorated share of debt notes and stocks. Now, that proration percentage will be announced sometime today. Phillips officials say over the weekend they received offers to sell more than 73 million shares of Phillips stock.
Coming up later on the Morning Edition, Gene Wheatley and Sarah Branscombe will be cooking up a delicious beef recipe. Sarah's from the Oklahoma Beef Commission.
And in our next half hour, Dr. Larry McCauley will be talking about the increase in teenage pregnancies.
We'll show you some of Oklahoma's brightest stars.
And how to keep your steers straight. Right now at 6:06.
On the next Merv Griffin Show, join me along with the A-Team's Dirk Benedict.
Yeah, so when I had cancer, I had cancer of the prostate.
That I knew.
And I talked about
that.
It can do it to you, yeah.
Award-winning instrumentalist Herbie Hancock and Chick Corea. Academy Award nominee Pat Morita.
I put in 9 years in a hospital when I was a youngster.
Oh. Merv, Monday at 9 on TV 9.
The stars were shining on two talented Oklahomans yesterday. The Star Search contest at the State Fairgrounds brought out some of Oklahoma's most talented and ambitious performers. They all had the same dream, to appear on the national TV talent show, Star Search. Michael Summers sang his way through the competition to the final round. He says there's a lot more to it than just being a star.
Being an entertainer gives you the opportunity through music and through media to reach out and touch somebody in a song. You know, whether it's your original music or whether it's you're singing somebody else's. You know, your interpretation can touch people, and that's what's good. That's what I like about being an entertainer.
Summers was named the winner of the singing competition, and Mark Boyd was named the winning comedian.
There was an awful lot of good talent there that night, or both nights. I was there Saturday, and there was a girl, I think one of the first girls that came on the stage and started singing, and I saw her come off the stage, and somebody tapped her on the shoulder, was writing something down. I think she got a job after she started singing there.
Wow.
There were some really good singers.
Maybe we should go out there.
Yeah.
We have no talent, that's our problem.
Yeah, really. I cannot hold a note, so I'll exclude from that. We'll give you a 10 for the weather. That was great yesterday.
Hey, that's fine. It's going to be great. Today's going to be great. Great. What's great? Fantastic, I guess would be a better word. Beautiful weather. Let's take a look at our temperatures right now, and our low, of course, about the same. Temperature continues to fall very slowly as the atmosphere begins to expand. Let's see, where am I? The relative humidity, 70%, the barometer at 30.19 inches of mercury, and steady at this hour. Winds are very, very light out of the south at about 2 miles per hour. I didn't even turn the radar on. Don't even pay attention to this. There's nothing out there. Let's take a look at temperatures. It's on the cool side, if not mild in some areas. 45 down in Lawton, 42 as well as Altus and Enid, 41 here in Oklahoma City. I had a letter from Mr. and Mrs. Merrifield over in Sayre. I want to know what the temperature in the Woodward Gauge area is. The problem with not putting it up there is they don't report 24 hours a day, okay, just during the daylight hours, basically from 6 to 6. And what we've done this morning is we kind of extrapolate temperature out there, probably around 38. Try to have it for you next hour when they open up the shop. 36 over at Salisaw at the present time. We take a look at satellite imagery. You can see a beautiful day is in store for much of the nation. And high pressure and dominance, a good bit of cloudiness down in southern Texas. A little bit of snow falling in the higher elevations out to the west, and snow this morning continuing to fall just off the coast and around portions of Massachusetts. Everything is clear of the state, basically. What we're going to wait on is pretty well defined, a little curve that you see out here in Southern California, or Central California, is a low and a weak cool front. That'll work on shore today, and that's going to be the next weather producer for Oklahoma in about 36 to 48 hours. So what we'll try to do is begin to move that thing on shore, and this is really going to be the only one that the in the way of precipitation. Got a very sharp blast of cooler air, which is going to work down through the Great Lakes into New England. It's going to bring winter back to those folks in the next 24 hours. In the meantime, it's not doing much, just bringing that cold air down through extreme northern portions of Minnesota, Wisconsin, and the peninsula of Michigan. Our little low will pulse in this direction, causing some showers and mainly, and some snow in the higher elevations, but it's not going to do a whole lot, not to us particularly here for a while, and just onshore flow, just a large area of high pressure which has cleared the eastern half of the country, is bringing southerly winds back across the Texas coast, and with that, they get enough lift and enough moisture probably supply a light shower stretching from the Galveston and Houston area back toward Brownsville during the day today. As we take a look at radar, this is onshore flow basically causing the problems out in central and northern California with some moderate
thunder showers, if you would, or moderate rain, which is occurring through Northern California, and a little snow continuing to fall off the East Coast, and some light rains just around a weak frontal system, actually, along the coast of the Carolinas, and then all the bad weather, which plagued Florida, has finally moved to the south into the Keys today. Now, during the day tomorrow, we'll begin to watch our little work in this direction. Our winds will begin to increase out of the south, but it really doesn't look as though we'll have enough at the time to help cause anything significant around Oklahoma. The chances for precipitation tomorrow will be about 20% in the panhandle, and the low should track just south of it. So we should see the heaviest weather associated with this system over in portions of central and southern Texas that begins to work out into the Gulf of Mexico. So the five-day outlook isn't too bad. An awful lot of sunshine today, an awful lot tomorrow, but we'll call it partly cloudy. And then here comes our little low. We'll give it about a 30% chance of some light rain, maybe an occasional thunderstorm associated with it. But the temperatures are going to be doing very, very nicely here in the next few days, up to 72 degrees tomorrow. We get kind of warm today as well. Our forecast for Oklahoma, we're just looking for sunny conditions and nice and warm today. Southerly winds at 10 to 15. Highs will range from, look at this, near 80 degrees out in the panhandle, or 78 in the northwest to 72 in the southeast. Tonight, fair and cool, light southerly winds. Lows will range from 40 northwest to 52 southeast. Tomorrow, partly cloudy and warm. Southerly winds at 10 to 15, increasing just a little bit, with highs ranging from 76 northwest to 72 southeast. It's going to be a couple boring days here for me, I'm afraid. 70 for a high today in Oklahoma City under an awful lot of sunshine. Tonight, fair and cool. A low of 43 tomorrow, just a little bit warmer, a high of 72 and a little more clouds, partly clouds, we begin to set ourselves up for a little activity. It doesn't look too major at the present time, so the week is going to go by, looks like pretty good. We'll have another round of thunderstorms to deal with possibly on Saturday. So that's a long way down the line.
That's great. Really, we like it when you're bored. It's nice weather.
Terrific.
Thanks a lot.
Ohio Governor Richard Chelsea says he'll allow the state's savings and loan associations to reopen in a matter of days. On Friday, he shut down the state chartered institutions after a run on deposits. The withdrawal spree followed the closing of the Cincinnati-based Home State Savings Bank. Today, the state legislature will meet in an emergency session. The lawmakers will consider a bill that would require privately insured SNLs to apply for coverage with the FSLIC. Salaries don't appear to be the issue anymore in the Mississippi teacher strike. The teachers union is rejecting a measure passed yesterday that includes $4,400 in pay raises. The union says the measure calls for excessive punishment for striking teachers.
Officials in Venice, Florida say dozens of residents spent the night in nursing homes following a tornado. Police patrolled the damaged homes to prevent looting during the night. Sunday's tornado killed two people, destroyed 55 homes, and severely damaged 120 others. A state of emergency has been declared in the area. Right now, it's 6:14, and just ahead, how can you tell one steer from another? Gene Wheatley has the answer for us when we return. Stay with us.
Farm Report is brought to you by Chevy Trucks. Nothing works like a Chevy truck.
Welcome back. It's about 17 after 6 o'clock. And Gene, when we were out at the Ultimate Warehouse sale, something was going on across the street there.
Yeah, Junior Livestock Show. Before we get into that, though, I got to ask you. I thought Mitch was semi-intelligent. You know, I've had questions about him, but tell the folks what you did out there. I hear this voice yelling from upon high.
And well, they had the hook and ladder truck out there. I don't know if you went out there, and I decided to climb the ladder.
How high was it?
Well, it was only up 60 feet.
Yeah, was it? Yeah, about that wide?
It's about this wide. And when you get to the top, it starts shaking pretty bad.
Well, Mitch, my opinion of your IQ is got concerned.
But I thought it was fun. I don't know.
Yeah, that's great. Now, your wife, I seen your wife down there wringing her hands. But anyway, that's okay. Smart guy, Mitch. Hey, the Junior Livestock Show is going on. Good morning to you. It's finally here, the 1985 Junior Livestock Show with all the kids and the livestock there. There has to be a system to keep all things straight.
as Newsline 9's Lola Hall found out.
How can you know for sure that number 611 is really number 611? This steer is about 400 pounds heavier than he was when the judge first took a look at him. Dr. Joe Hughes says it's no problem. They take a nose print.
We take the approach that the nose print is really like the human fingerprint. The muzzle of a bovine animal is unique for that particular individual.
A nose print is taken at county nomination time back in November. That print is matched up with this print to ensure the same animal turns up for the show. Sunshine's owner, Jason Riddle, says he thinks it's a good idea.
It kind of helps the people here to kind of go through and eliminate the ones that shouldn't be shown. And it's just a little better practice, I think.
And I see the triangle and the puppy foot underneath, the triangle and the puppy foot here.
Now it is official. Sunshine is who Sunshine says he is. And what happens next is up to Sunshine and the judges. Getting ready for the judges in Monday's steer show will go on all day. Cattle are weighed, average daily gain is calculated, then they are divided into classes.
The cattle will also be measured at the hip. We're using hip height measurement as a means of dividing our steers into class for show purposes.
To show an animal at the Oklahoma Junior Livestock Show is the ultimate goal for these youngsters. Officials say they can't be too careful in making sure everything is as it should be for them. Lola Hall, Newsline 9.
Thank you, Lola. It's the world's biggest junior livestock show. It really is. And Nelson, you've got some good weather for us, and everybody out there at the show says, thank you, sir.
You're quite welcome. Did you pick up the money for me?
Yeah. No, I'm taking up a collection.
Whenever the weather's good like that, you got to take credit for it because they blame me for the bad, right? So pass a hat if you would.
That's true.
Take a look at the weather around Oklahoma today. It's going to be somewhat nice. Drying potential is going to be very, very good. Temperatures right now on the cool side, but as the sun pops up across the horizon there, we'll look for a rapid warm-up in the 70s for everybody across the state. We'll be looking for a very weak system at the present time to begin to work in this direction, and it will present some problems possibly Wednesday, but they should be very, very minor. We're not looking at a major outbreak of weather here. We're see our relative humidities will average about 20% across much of the state today, and drying potentials will be good. Look for dew to keep vegetation wet for about 6 hours here for the next couple of days for small grain and the like. Far as livestock management, nothing more than what's being done presently. Cool nights and nice warm days.
Thank you, Nelson. You've been here how long now?
This is what, 2 months?
2 months in Louisiana. That makes two in a row. Two good ones, Nelson. You're on a roll, son. Keep it going. You did good. Out at the stockyards this Monday morning, they have 3,323 head of cattle already on hand. 392 hogs are expecting 4,300 head of cattle today, 200 calves, and about 800 hogs. Let's review last week's prices and listen to a little Mickey Gilly this morning.
Thank you. Next on Different Strokes.
Arnold had a bad dream.
You mean I was dreaming?
Don't you two think it's kind of a coincidence that he started having these nightmares right after I canceled the fishing trip?
I think he means you should see a psychiatrist.
What you talking about, Willis? This looks like an oogie.
Thank you, pardon?
An oogie. Didn't my dad tell you about my dreams?
Different Strokes, weekdays at 3:30 on TV9.
Minutes after the hour, 6 o'clock. It's a Monday morning. Delighted to have Sarah Branscombe with us this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
You're going to answer one of my hard problems. Maggie and I, as my wife, have a new microwave. And I noticed when I cook beef in it, I have some problems.
Uh-huh.
And I'm doing something wrong. You done told me. All right. So what are we going to cook this morning?
Well, we're going to show how to do beef burgers successfully.
Okay.
Unlike perhaps the way you've been doing them, right?
Yes. Thanks to the Beef Commission, by the way. We have some nice lean hamburger meat here.
Yes. This is ground beef, and these weigh about 5 1/3 ounces.
Okay.
In other words, 3 to a pound. Do them about 4 to a pound or 3 to a pound, and this is the trick: is that after you form the patty, poke a hole in the middle, make it like a donut, because in microwave cooking. The center won't cook evenly if you just leave the patty solid.
Why is that?
Well, because the microwaves only penetrate about 1 to 1.5 inches.
I see.
So the outer portion's going to be a little overcooked before the inner portion gets done just right. So this will cause them to cook evenly.
See, actually, let me hold up.
Yeah, make a little donut there.
There's a little beef patty out on this camera. There you go. It's like a donut.
And, about 3/4 of an inch.
Wow, okay.
I mean, that has to be real precise, 3/4 of an inch. And then just put them in like an 8 by 8 inch baking dish.
Okay.
Of course, you know, microwave-proof dish. And then I've got this mixture of salt and paprika and a little bit of flour. It has 2 tablespoons of salt, 2 teaspoons of flour, teaspoon of paprika, and 1/4 teaspoon of black pepper.
Wow.
And I just mixed it up in a little shaker and sprinkle some of that on because, you know, in microwave cooking, you don't get the browning that's quite as desirable.
That I have no. Now, some of the microwaves, they'll have a browner.
Yes.
Ours has a browner. We do not know how to use it yet, but it has a browner.
Well, you might want to read the use and care booklet that came with your microwave. That would be helpful. But sprinkle a little bit of this on, and it'll give it a nicer color.
Okay, now when this thing starts cooking, you mean that little stuff you sprinkle on the side, on the top of that, is going to make it brown?
It'll help because the paprika gives them a nice little bit of color.
Okay.
Besides that, now, although I purchased lean ground beef, not extremely lean, you still want some fat for juiciness and flavor.
You bet.
But the fat in the meat will also help to brown it.
Okay.
Then just cover it with wax paper.
So it doesn't splatter all of your oven.
Right.
My wife jumps on me on that more times.
I do the same thing to my
husband. Yeah.
But put this over the top, and that holds in just enough moisture and also helps them cook evenly. Cook them about 1.5 minutes, and then rotate it just to aid in even cooking, and then rotate it, cook it 1.5 minutes more, and that's on high power.
Uh-huh.
And they look great.
That is great.
I sprinkle a little cheese on them and some green chilies. And
You microwave these yourself?
I microwave those, honest.
Wow.
I think they look good.
They look really appetizing. But we don't have a fork.
Well, I've got a knife, and I'll cut one up for
you
later.
I'll have to sample them later. They look delicious, though. And they smell fantastic. Mm-hmm. Ooh, okay. Real quick, got the booklet.
Terrific booklet.
Okay.
Beef that satisfies the microwave way.
Okay.
It's a real nice booklet. You can see by the size that it has lots of recipes. Oklahoma Beef Commission, 312 Northeast 28th Street,
there's
Oklahoma
the address
City,
on the screen.
73105.
Okay.
We'd love to send you this free booklet.
All righty. That's great. And then I won't make sloppy beef burgers. Okay. Thank you, sir. I appreciate it a bunch. Guys, I'm going to be thinking about it. It's National Ag Week. Did you know that? Anyway, I got some thoughts on it coming up in the next section.
Sounds good, Gene. Right now it's 6:29. In our next half hour, Dr. Larry McCauley on teenage pregnancies.
Ed Murray will have all the scores from this weekend's NCAA action.
And a new high-tech art form. Stay with us.
What is Jeopardy?
TV9's most popular trivia game show. Join Alex Trebek weekdays at 4:30 for this challenging half-hour program as contestants try to win hundreds of dollars by answering with correct Jeopardy questions. It's fun, exciting, and informative. Trivia with a twist. Test your knowledge from the assortment of categories. Remember, it pays to show how much you know.
I don't think I could have said it any better myself.
TV9's most popular trivia game show, weekdays at 4:30. Join Alex Trebek only on TV9.
We've got a challenge for Nelson here. We want him to provide us with the weather we had yesterday for the rest
of the week.
Well, in the spring, in the summer.
See, spring is official here the 21st, so we have a few days left. But it's
Thursday.
Yeah, kind of whipping in here, kind of nice. Yesterday, as we said earlier, almost a 10, right?
It was great.
Yeah,
was
today's going to be just as nice. I can't promise it all through the week. Wednesday, we'll have a few more clouds and maybe a little rain, but not too bad. Let's take a look at temperatures around the state right now, and it's rather comfortable in some areas. 35 down at McAllister is actually the cool spot. 41 here in Oklahoma City. The Woodward Gauge area, an extrapolation there, we'll say probably around 38 degrees at this hour, and we'll be looking for a rapid warm-up. There's an awful lot of sunshine, full day of it. And we do have some weather, though. It's coming, as we said, Wednesday, and I'll look down the line, and I'll tell you exactly when we can expect it.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot. Everyone knows how technology has changed the workplace, but it's making its presence felt in other areas, such as art.
Nick Walker has the story of one artist and his high-tech creation, a light sculpture.
What is it? That's the first question that comes from everyone who sees these dancing streams of light. It's a type of sculpture, but not in the traditional sense. Artist Bill Parker calls these brilliant balls of lightning bolts star sculpture.
I'm using a lot of the same ideas, a lot of the same concepts, except what I'm sculpting is totally intangible. You can't touch it.
To make it, Bill fills hand-blown glass globes with as many as 25 different kinds of gases. A small computer emits electronic signals through the hemisphere of a small glass stem extending into the globe. The result is a shimmering snake-like beam of light, or multiple beams reaching out like glimmering tentacles. And just by touching the glass, you can change the effect of the light.
The moisture content in your body is very high. You're well over two-thirds water, and water is conductive. So when you put your hands on the back of the globe or the top or the sides and move it around, the light is following you by virtue of the fact that electricity is being attracted to you. And where there's electricity in the gas, you have light.
Artist Bill Parker knows he's created something unique, but he's not content to stop here.
The ultimate goal here is to be able to produce the sculpture just in thin air.
You can buy these sculptures. You can if you have $2,500 to $3,000. But it doesn't cost you anything to look, to touch, and to stand in awe. Nick Walker for CBS News, Seattle.
That's pretty wild.
$2,500. I'll just take my flashlight and run it across the trees at night. Huh?
You're easily amused, right?
Heck yeah, boy.
There you go.
Well, still to come on the morning edition, we'll have all the scores from this week's NCAA tournament action.
And Nelson Robinson will tell us if we have another day of beautiful spring weather in store.
And I've got to think about it. It's National Ag Week, and I'll give you some Aggie facts. First of all, let's check cash grain prices at Oklahoma Elevators for a Monday morning on the Cash Grain Report.
Taking place, put the glue on every
sad for girls at all. Cause I'm no Robert Redford, even Overhaul. We all picture in our minds a girl.
It's now 6:37. Let's check in with Nelson and Alicia for some trivia and some sunny weather.
Yes, got a little bit of both.
Do you want to go first?
No, after you, please.
Well,
ladies first.
In 1931, on this day in 1931, Schick marketed something for
the
first
time. Oh, I
read that one. That's the only one he read.
The electric razor.
Yeah. Your face hasn't ever been the same,
right? That's right. I don't use electric.
You probably weren't shaving in 1931.
There's a lot of things I wasn't doing in 31. Okay, here's one for you. Okay. It has to do with the first spacewalk.
Uh-huh.
Okay, who did it? The United States or Russia?
It was Russia.
Okay.
I knew that one.
Did you?
Yeah.
Okay, you know the cosmonaut's name?
No.
Okay, I couldn't pronounce it either, so we're not going to use that one. Who was the first American to walk in space?
Oh, gosh. It wasn't John Glenn.
No. Alicia missed one. It was Edward White.
Henry White?
Edward White.
White.
Yeah, he was later killed in a test project, the Apollo 11, I think it was, in Miami.
Oh. I didn't know that.
Yeah, well, it's a sad note this morning. But let's take a look at the weather and kind of cheer things up. A lot of sunshine out there, or not yet. It will be very shortly. 41 is our current temperature. That's our low for the day, or this morning. Boy, Mondays are tough, aren't they? Relative humidity at 70%, barometer at 30.19 inches of mercury, and steady at this hour. And we don't have anything to look at radar because we don't have any clouds out there. It's going to be another great day. Yesterday was a 9.9 as we rate it. Today will probably be about 9.75, 9.8, somewhere close to that. Let's take a look at temperatures. It is on the cool side in a lot of areas. 41 here in Oklahoma City, 42 in Enid as well. There's the Altus area, 45 at Lawton, and we'll be looking for the cool spot, actually, McAllister, as we said earlier, 35. And the winds are very, very light, if or non-existent for the most part, so we don't have a wind chill out there this morning, and it will warm rapidly with a full day of sunshine. We take a look at satellite imagery. You can see that much of the country is going to have a very, very pleasant day, except southern Texas, portions of California around San Francisco, and they've got some snow, which is falling at the present time over around Boston, and just all that's working offshore, so their day is going to get a little bit better. Actually, what they're bracing for is about maybe 8 hours of nice weather before some very cold air begins to work in that direction. I say 12 to 18 hours before some winter-like weather returns to New England. In the meantime, upper-level disturbance will begin to work in this direction, maybe slowly work itself to the surface. It's weak but large in some senses. It will produce some light rain to some moderate rains in portions of Utah and Arizona later today. This will work in this direction. Promises to move south of us. If we're going to trigger any thunderstorm activity, I think that will be south as well. Very slight chance of seeing some of that around Oklahoma on Wednesday. But really a pleasant day. I don't have a whole lot to talk about. I got showers prominent through central and northern California at the present time, working into northern Nevada, and the snow, which we talked about earlier, just moving offshore in New England, and some light flurries at the present time in North Carolina, as well as rain along the coast. But everywhere in between, just really, really nice. We'll be looking for this low to continue to move in this direction. Onshore flow, just the circulation around a rather large area of high pressure, will probably bring a very slight chance of showers to South Texas and southeastern Texas. But this is the weathermaker and the talk for the next couple days as this system begins to work in this direction. So the five-day outlook is going to be nice. Look for a lot of sunshine today, a lot of sunshine tomorrow, a few more clouds, temperatures up into the 70s, cooling off as we see a good bit more cloudiness. We'll call it partly to mostly cloudy on Wednesday with a slight chance of thunderstorms. And then we'll turn around rather rapidly. Our forecast for the state, sunny and warm today. Look for southerly winds at 10 to 15 miles per hour. Let's see, highs will range from 78 northwest to 72 in the southeast tonight. Fair and cool. Southerly winds at 5 to 10. Lows ranging from 40 northwest to 52 in the southeast. That's kind of a mild evening, I guess. Tomorrow, partly cloudy and a little warmer. A little more clouds, too. Suddenly winds at 10 to 15, winds increasing, a little gusty. They tell me I got all kinds of time. Let's see here, 76 for high out in the panhandle, the 72 in the southeast. And for Oklahoma City, yes, sunburn today in some cases, a high of 70 degrees. Look for fair and cool conditions tonight, a low of 43, and a high tomorrow of 72 under partly cloudy skies. So those people who want to wash their cars, this is the time to do it. Now, the chance, again, on Wednesday, right now, about 30%, so that's not too bad.
No.
There was a study done, by the way, that a sociologist who was working with Dr. Neil Frank of the Hurricane Center, and we were discussing this. I think that it's 40%
probabilities have to be about 40% before people actually start carrying umbrellas or preparing themselves.
Start worrying about it. Yeah.
It's true, you know, so 30%, not too bad.
So we won't worry about it.
No, we'll just forget it then. Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Well, in sports, the number of teams in the NCAA tournament has been whittled down to 16. The fourth-ranked Sooners made the cut after defeating Illinois State Saturday.
But one highly rated team expected to make the final 16 didn't. Ed Murray reports.
Good morning, everyone. Oklahoma will play Louisiana Tech Thursday afternoon at 5:30 in Dallas as the round of 16 gets underway in the NCAA basketball championships. Oklahoma has reached the final 16. Second-ranked Michigan, the top seed in the Southeast Regional, has not. They were upset by Villanova yesterday. Ed Pinckney leading the way for Villanova down low and in the middle, slams home two of his 14 points right there. Dwayne McClain brought Villanova back from a five-point deficit in the second half. He had 20 points, most of them in the second half. Villanova hit 11 of 13 free throws in the last 97 seconds, outscoring Michigan 25-3 from the line and winning it 59-55. As we look at the scoreboard in the other game in the Southeast Regional, Maryland has advanced over Navy 64-59. In the West Regional, Alabama has upset Virginia Commonwealth 63-59, and North Carolina State over Texas El Paso 86-73. The East Regional, Georgia Tech over Syracuse and Illinois clobbered Georgia. In the Georgia Tech-Syracuse game, Tech was led by Enid's Mark Price. Watch Price get up here on the fast break. A beautiful play, the easy layup, 18 points for Mark Price, leading scorer for Georgia Tech. Tech had the big muscle inside against Syracuse. Here's Yvonne Joseph slamming in two of his 17 points. Watch Price now as he deflects the pass right here. John Sally gets the steal and the dunk. He scored 10 of his 13 points in the second half as Georgia Tech pulled away in the second half. Watch Price coming up here. The great pass to Bruce Dalrymple. Dalrymple with 10 points. Price, another outstanding game. Georgia Tech, a winner. In the Midwest Regional, it was Memphis State in overtime over Alabama Birmingham, 67-66. Boston College by a point over Duke, 74-73. Keith Lee led Memphis State in that game with 28 points, including the free throw that sent it into overtime. Here's Lee in the lane with 2 minutes to go. In overtime, it was tied. Andre Turner, actually Memphis State was down by one. Andre Turner gets the game winner on that shot. He had 23 points. Birmingham's last chance was partially blocked. Gene Bartow wanted a foul, didn't get it. Memphis State wins by a point. Michael Adams led Boston College with 19 points. Look at that move right there for Adams. BC was up 73-71, 15 seconds to go. Johnny Dawkins misses the 1-1. Tyron Scott was fouled before the shot went in off the rebound, so Scott got the game-winning free throw as Boston College won it 74-73. They were celebrating more than St. Patrick's Day over the weekend in Weatherford. Southwestern brought home its third NAIA Women's Basketball National Championship in the last 4 years. They defeated Saginaw Valley on Saturday in the title game. Shelley Brown led Southwestern with 21 points to overcome an 8-point Saginaw lead in the first half. Beverly Sanders, though, led Saginaw with 19 points. This made it 44-43 Saginaw. You're going to see some bad video. It is not your set. It was video from Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Kelly Lish, the All-American, hit a layup with 2 minutes to go. Southwestern led by a point. Lish had just 12 points. Sanders answers, though, 52-51 Saginaw. 1:16 to play. Delisa Stroud makes it 53-52 Bulldogs. She had 10. 52 seconds to go. Sophia Yarger answers. 1-point lead for Saginaw. 18 seconds to play. Who else? Kelly Lish, 16 feet. Good. The game winner, 55-54. Southwestern. Sanders missing the final attempt for Saginaw. Southwestern, the national champions again.
We've been here 4 years, but we won it the three out of the four. This is definitely the most satisfying for me because this is our last year, and we got beat last year, and we had something to prove this year, and came back and went 34-0 and won the national championship. You can't ask for anything better than that.
What are you going to do with the trophy now?
I'm just going to set it on my dresser at home and look at it for the rest of my life.
Again, we apologize for the video. We certainly will miss Kelly Lish, a graduating senior at Southwestern under Lish. They were 129 wins, 5 losses, 3 national championships. In golf yesterday, Seve Ballesteros won the rain shortened U.S. FNG Classic in New Orleans. Ballesteros came to the 16th green trailing John Mahaffey by a shot, but rolled in his beautiful birdie putt. Ballesteros and Mahaffey were tied at 11 under par. Ballesteros then on 17, just trying to get it close and steady, rams it in the hole for another birdie, a one-shot lead at that point. He bogeyed 18, but Mahaffey double bogeyed 18. Look at the leaderboard. Seve Ballesteros wins at 11 under par, the U.S. F&G Classic. 2 shots over Peter Jacobson and John Mahaffey. The ladies played the Kemper Open in Hawaii. Jane Blaylock won it on the last hole. She defeated Pat Bradley Blaylock at 5 under par. Pro football has returned to the city of Baltimore as the USFL Stars have played their first home game, the first pro game since the Colts left town. After Doug Flutie threw an interception for New Jersey, Chuck Fusina got Baltimore on the scoreboard, almost called him Philadelphia. Kelvin Bryant, the touchdown, 7-0. Bryant, a touchdown run coming up here. He had 136 yards on the day rushing. 13-0 Baltimore at the half. Fusina threw a second touchdown pass in the second half, this one going to Victor Harrison for the score, as Baltimore defeated New Jersey. The final was 29-9. As we look at the other scores in the USFL, Birmingham beat Memphis 34-19, and Jacksonville losing at Oakland 42-36. Bill Elliott won this week's stop on the NASCAR circuit, and Martina Navratilova, it's early, folks, defeated Chris Everett Lloyd in the Virginia Slims event in Dallas yesterday. Ed Murray, Sportsline 9.
All righty. Well, still to come on the morning edition, Gene Wheatley will have some thoughts about National Ag Week.
And Dr. Larry McCauley will be talking about the increase in teenage pregnancies.
And we'll join a celebration of miracles right now at 6:47. Stay with us.
On a Monday morning. Well, this is National Ag Week in America. This purpose is to honor this country's number one industry. Now, we're going to celebrate it in Oklahoma real big, too, because it's our number one industry also. Now, here's some of the things that you ought to think about since it's Ag Week. Oklahoma ranks near the top nationally in the production of several important farm commodities. During most of the last 10 years, Oklahoma has been second in the nation in winter wheat production, fifth or sixth in cattle and calves. Also, in recent years, the Sooner State has ranked sixth in peanut production, third in pecans, and fifth in grain sorghum, seventh in cotton. So you can see it's really big. Three-fourths of this state's land is in 72,500 farms and ranches, which have assets of more than $29 billion and produce more than $3 billion a year in commodities annually. Oklahoma is agriculture. I like the way Benjamin Franklin put it. He says, quote, "There seems to be three ways for a nation to acquire wealth. The first is by war, as the Romans did in plundering their conquered neighbors. This is robbery. The second by commerce, which is generally cheating. The third by agriculture, the only honest way, wherein man receiving a real increase of the seed thrown into the ground and a kind of continual miracle wrought by the hand of God in his favor as a reward for his innocent life and his virtuous industry." Think about it, and we'll be right back.
On the next Merv Griffin Show, join me along with the A-Team's Dirk Benedict.
Yeah, so when I had cancer, I had cancer of the prostate.
That I knew.
And I talked about
that.
It can do it to you, yeah.
Award-winning instrumentalists Herbie Hancock and Chick Corea. Academy Award nominee Pat Morita.
I put in 9 years in a hospital when I was a youngster.
Oh.
Merv, Monday at 9 on TV 9.
The number of teenage girls getting pregnant is on the rise, not just across the country, but here in Oklahoma as well. Here to talk with us this morning about this growing problem is psychologist Dr. Larry McCauley. Good morning.
Hi.
Psychologist here in town with a practice here in Oklahoma City. We've got some figures. You gave me these figures over the weekend. I find them kind of shocking. I'd like to put those up on the screen to show folks just how big a problem this is across our state. And tell us what we're seeing here.
Well, I think a lot of the things, especially what got me, are the ones that are under 13 years of age. We've got about two children that are born to children that are 13 years and younger. As you look, they're 13 years and older. We've got 33. I won't insult your intelligence to read this yourself, but as they get older, we see an increasing number of children being born to children. 15-year-olds, look at that. 16-year-olds, there are 1,036. Jumps all the way up to the 19-year-olds, we have 3,740. That's alarming.
Yeah, it is. And it's Oklahoma alone. When you have to kind of take a double take, that's 10,000 kids. And I thought maybe it was Southwest region, but no, it's Oklahoma statistics.
It's Oklahoma.
Alone. Is the idea of sex education years back was that kids were not educated enough, so they brought sex education into the schools. Now their theory is that maybe they know too much.
Well, it seems to be that I think a lot of professionals now are beginning to wonder, are we giving them too much too soon? You know, we start sex education back in the early elementary years. And I think as we look at that, we become a little concerned about that and how are we teaching that. And I guess personally I'm beginning to wonder about the efficacy of teaching kids this young, because they say, well, we teach it with no values. Well, you can't teach anything without values. And I think it's real scary to see these figures. And we just can't say it's sex education alone.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're we're doing an injustice to the education system to do that. There are other things. I think we hurry our kids too much. The media does it. We portray women in such a way that they're very sexy and provocative, and little girls see this. And so they try to dress that way, and then they try to be that way. They try to be adults, and they can't handle that. And they're really children without a childhood, and that's kind of sad.
You're saying that we're almost forcing our kids to be adults before they're ready to be adults.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, and it's very frightening.
Is there something parents can do to help their kids?
Oh, yeah. One of the things that I find with young girls this age, especially in the adolescence and teen years, is that they really need to have good, healthy physical contact with a male, with dad. And that's the time when dads really start pushing back. They don't want anything to do with their daughters because they're developing. That's a little frightening for dads to hug them. And so I think there needs to be more of a contact with dad in a healthy kind of way to help them. If they don't get it there, they're going to go elsewhere to get it, as these statistics show. I think we need to spend more time. We've heard this for years. We need to spend more time with our kids. We're too busy as professionals, as working people, to take care of our kids. 5 to 10 million kids in America are latchkey kids. They don't. They have to go home without moms and dads. That leads to this, too, I think, one of the variables.
So you're almost suggesting then kind of a sex education at home.
Yes.
A relationship,
but
just
we're afraid
in education.
To talk about sex.
Well, should we?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Answer their questions when they give you questions. Oh, we don't want to talk about sex. I mean, that's just, it shows that the people that can talk about it openly and not in a threatening kind of way, those kids are better equipped to handle sexual relationships, interpersonal relationships.
What's the right age? When do you approach your kids?
Oh, gee. When they approach you. When they approach you. And sometimes that's very early. Mm-hmm. You know, you begin talking about that. 8, 7, 6. But answer them truthfully. Give them the right kinds of answers. Don't hedge. Don't get shocked. Oh, you said that? Oh, my. You know, handle it very maturely and go on. And that's the best education we as parents can do. And it needs to start at home, not somewhere else, I think.
Sounds good. All right. Thank you. We're out of time. Yeah. We appreciate you joining us, Dr. Larry McCauley.
Thank you.
All righty.
Yeah.
We'll be back in just a second. Don't go away. Look like the Blues Brothers here. Look at these two. My goodness.
A couple shades and
that's
some
hats.
Right. And the Purple Sister. I like that.
That's right.
I think we're going to have some more long lines at the car wash today.
Yeah,
right?
Today's going to be great to wash your car, to do all those nice things, except work. You have to be inside. Let's take a look at the five-day outlook. A lot of sunshine today. Good bit of it tomorrow, but we'll see increasing cloudiness. Very slight chance of showers and a thunderstorm will pop up around on Wednesday. But beautiful today and a little warmer tomorrow. Spring. It's not officially
it's
here, but
way.
It's here. Right?
Two in a row for you.
Two in a row.
Yeah. Okay,
great. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
Nancy Rogers and her family celebrated two miracles yesterday. One took place 18 years ago. The other took place more recently. Newsline 9's Phil Van Staveren reports.
Nancy Rogers is a miracle because, as she puts it, she has been snatched from the hands of death several times. Nancy Ann Rogers is Nancy's own special miracle, and she's 18 today. When Nancy Rogers was battling Hodgkin's disease and later a failing heart, Nancy Ann had taken over most of the household duties. There's a very special bond between them, revealed in Nancy Rogers' words.
She really is a miracle baby, and she's just, you know, real special. She was 2 months premature, and she weighed it at 4 pounds and 10 ounces. And she's just, had a fantastic life. She had beautiful curly hair and red brown eyes and a great big dimple in her cheek and just looked like an angel when she was born. And we were so excited after losing 3 boys to finally have this beautiful little girl to have and love.
Nancy Rogers says her family is a family of tradition, and most of the people at this birthday party had been at Nancy Ann's other birthdays. But this one is more special than the others. Nancy Rogers had the special honor of giving her daughter a wonderful pink gown for her senior prom. And Nancy Ann gets to have her mother because of her new heart, hopefully for a long, long time. Phil Van Staveren, Newsline 9.
Great. We were just commenting how good she looks. Yes, she just had a heart transplant. She looks wonderful.
Fantastic.
That's good.
I want everybody to go by the IJA Market in Stillwater today. Mike Wright is my brother-in-law. He rode a horse for the first time yesterday, and he's almost old as I am.
You can pick him out because he's walking full-legged.
Yeah, gimps and limps on, but he did well. I got to give him credit.
All righty. That's our show for today. Now stay tuned for the CBS Morning News.
Have a good day.
Bye-bye.